to the third session. And the speaker and the topic is mining markers during the second trimester ultrasonography by Dr. Preeti Venkatesh. Dr. Preeti Venkatesh graduated MS from KMC Mangalore, practicing obstetric and gynec ultrasound since 1987 and fetal medicine since 1992. Presently, she is a consultant and the HOD of Department of Fetal Medicine, Manipal Hospital, Bangalore. She is also the president of Medical Ultrasound Society of Karnataka. Over to you, ma'am.
I wish you a very good afternoon. I would like to thank Dr. Sridevi and her team for inviting me here to give the lectures. I'm going to talk to you on second trimester markers of aneuploidy. Minor markers, major concerns. Yes, they do cause a lot of confusion, a lot of anxiety when we come across these markers. We started off aneuploidy screening way back in the late 80s with second trimester markers and followed by second trimester biochemistry. But with the introduction of NT, nuchal translucency in the 90s, and the first trimester biochemistry thereafter, second trimester screening took a backseat. However, the second trimester screening is done at a very opportune time. We do it at the mid-trimester anomaly scan, and there is no way I see a mid-trimester anomaly scan not being needed in the next few years. So as long as we are going to do a mid-trimester anomaly scan, we are going to see some markers. We are going to detect these during the routine scan. And over a period of time, we have noticed that new and new markers are being added. And some of these have implications even beyond aneuploidy itself. For example, aberrant right subclavian artery is a marker of chromosomal abnormality, Down syndrome. However, if there is no Down syndrome, then you need to look into whether the fetus has digeorge. So aneuploidy, if you look at detection rates for aneuploidy, with first trimester screening and second trimester screening, first trimester screening has excellent detection rates. 82% with 3% false positive rate with NT and biochemistry, and if you add nasal bone, it goes up to 91%. Having such good detection rate, if you compare the second trimester, it's only in the range of 60 to 80%. 80% if you combine age, genetic sonogram and QST. So is there a need to do this screening? Yes, there is a role, Bell Limited, for genetic sonogram, and this includes even the high-risk pregnancies. When women get screened in the first trimester and the risk comes high, not everybody accepts invasive testing. There may be a small percentage of women who are anxious about doing invasive testing and therefore may avoid invasive testing and may wait for second trimester scans or tests to decide whether she really wants to do a test or not. The low-risk women who are borderline low, the intermediate range, who are just outside the cutoff, these would be anxious to know whether the risk is really high with further testing or not, and they would benefit from a genetic sonogram. Women who did not have a first trimester screening at all, twin gestations. In twin gestation, especially the DCDA twins we are talking about, in this, the one fetus may be affected and the other may not, and so the parameters of one will overshadow the parameters of the other. So biochemical screening is not effective for dichorionic twin gestation, and therefore ultrasound screening is preferred, and first and second trimester ultrasound screening will give better detection rates. And sometimes when you're doing an anomaly scan, you'll pick up some markers, and then what do? You have to evaluate them, look at the risk, calculate the risk, and counsel the couple. So when we do a mid-trimester anomaly scan, we often refer to it as genetic sonogram because we are looking at markers routinely. So we look for structural anomalies, and then we look for these markers. Depending upon the presence of these markers, we modify their previous risk, that is the a priori risk or the previous risk, and give them a new risk. We must remember that the markers that we are looking at are not pathological findings. They are just variations of normal. They are seen in normal fetuses. They are seen in Down's fetuses. They do not have any great pathological significance by themselves. Now, when we come across these markers, the best policy is to use likelihood ratios, which will help you calculate a very accurate risk and makes counseling easy. What is likelihood ratio? Likelihood ratio is nothing but number given to each marker depending upon its importance. It tells us the probability or the chance of a woman having Downs if she tests positive for this particular marker. For example, let us say there is a marker with a likelihood ratio of 5. What does that likelihood ratio tell you? Suppose I find this marker X in a woman, then her chance of having a baby with Downs has increased 5 times. That is what we mean. Now, this is a typical example of a positive likelihood ratio. That is, you have a marker and you multiply that by the likelihood ratio, the a priori risk, and you give a new risk. Usually the risk increases. If you have a marker, the risk of chromosomal abnormality increases. Now, what if the woman does not have a marker? Does it make a difference? Yes. If she does not have a particular marker, her risk will go down by a certain amount. And that certain amount by which the risk will go down is referred to as the negative likelihood ratio. So as you can see here, your positive likelihood ratios are bigger numbers, 3, 4, 2, so on. Whereas negative likelihood ratios are decimals because they are small proportion by which the risk decreases when a marker is not there. So how do we calculate these likelihood ratios? Likelihood ratio is defined as the ratio of the prevalence of or incidence of a marker in Downs divided by the prevalence or incidence of a particular marker in the normal fetus. Okay? So I'll give you an example. Suppose you have a marker which is present in 66% of Downs babies. That is why it is a marker. It's so common in Downs. However, in the normal population, you see it in 6%. So if you divide 66 by 6, you get a number 11. That becomes the likelihood ratio for this particular marker. Similarly, you can see down, if you have a marker that is present in 45% of the Downs and only 15% of normal fetuses, then the likelihood ratio in that case would be 3. So that is how you calculate likelihood ratios. Now, the list of markers has been increasing. As studies are added on, as people's experience increases with a particular finding, more and more markers are coming, and this increases your anxiety as well as the anxiety of the patients. Until recently, we had 5 markers, that is echogenic intracardiac focus that you see here, that is the echogenic intracardiac focus, increased nuchal fold, then you had pelviectasis, hyperechogenic bowel, and short humerus, short femur. Now we have added on 3, that is nasal bone, absent or hypoplastic nasal bone, ventricular megaly, and aberrant right subclavian artery. Now what was happening all this time? Now the aberrant right subclavian artery is the subclavian artery for the right side arising from the descending aorta after all the 3 head and neck vessels are given off. Because it is arising from the descending aorta, you see it coursing behind, that's the trachea, and it courses behind the trachea. This aberrant right subclavian artery has an association with Downs, and that's why it is a marker of chromosomal abnormality, particularly Down syndrome. Now, until recently, what we were doing, we were using the 5 markers, and then if I find a hypoplastic nasal bone, I would go to the literature, find out what is the likelihood ratio most people are using, select one likelihood ratio and use it for my patients, and multiply the risk that I get from genetic sonogram by that likelihood ratio and give a new risk if I find the absent nasal bone. Similarly with other markers. However, we have recently in 2013, Agatha Cleos et al. Did a meta-analysis and they studied about 48 studies they looked into from 95 to 2012, and they pulled in all the markers, their detection rate, the likelihood ratios, and have given us a comprehensive pooled data. So we can straight away use this data for now these 7 to 8 markers that we have available on a standard basis. So that is short humerus, short femur, the usual 5 markers including ventriculomegaly, absent hypoplastic nasal bone, and ARSA, that is aberrant right subclavian artery. Okay. Now when we use this parameter, there are only 2 parameters that are interrelated in these. That is the short humerus and short femur. If a fetus has short femur, it may be constitutional, and it is quite possible that femur will have short humerus also. So if you are going to use both these, you are doubly adding the risk to the same fetus for a single problem that the fetus has. So if you use short humerus, you should not include the short femur, and if you use short femur, you should not. You can use one of them. If you have just one, then you use just the short femur and omit the humerus. That is how we use this. Now this chart shows you the various parameters and the definition that was used in various studies that were used in this meta-analysis. I've shown you this only to show that a lot of different cutoffs or different ways of looking at these parameters is going on. For example, they're using MOMs and not just percentiles for femur length and humerus length. They are computing femur length and humerus length against BPD rather than against gestational age. So there are a lot of variations happening. However, the last column tells you the conventional methods that we have been using so far, which we can continue to use because some of the studies use these parameters as well. So what we do is short humerus, short femur less than the 5th centile, EIF present or not, a hyperechogenic bowel grade 3, pelviectasis, the definition ranged from more than or equal to 3 to more than or equal to 5 millimeters, but most studies, almost 87% of the studies use 4 millimeters as a cutoff. So you can use 4 millimeters, or you can say 4 millimeters before 20 weeks and 5 millimeters after 20 weeks. Increased nuchal fold remains the same, more than equal to 6 millimeters. Hyperechogenic bowel grade 3, that is equal to the echogenicity of the bone. Ventricular megaly more than equal to 10 millimeters. And of course, aberrant right subclavian present or not. Nasal bone present, I mean absent, or hypoplastic. Now, when you use these markers, suppose you have got only one marker, isolated marker, you did a detailed scan, did not find any other markers whatsoever, and no other structural anomalies. In that case, you need not do any calculations. You straight away go to this last column of isolated markers and use that number. Suppose you got mild pelviectasis. You straight away, your likelihood ratio for this fetus is, for calculating aneuploidy, 1.08. You don't need to do any calculations. But if you have 2 or more markers, you need to calculate. How do you calculate? The markers that you have found positive, you use the positive likelihood ratio of those markers, and those that you found negative, you use a negative likelihood ratio. Now in this fetus, EIF and absent nasal bone were found. So you use positive likelihood ratio for EIF, positive likelihood ratio for nasal bone, absent nasal bone, and the negative for all others, but you must remember to use only one, either humerus or femur and not both. You multiply all this and you will get a likelihood ratio of 47.8. So the likelihood ratio jumps significantly once you have more than one marker. So now if you look at these markers, you will see that there are markers with different weightage. There are some that will not increase the risk significantly. In fact, they will even, when in isolation, they will even marginally decrease the risk. There are others that will increase the risk 3 to 4-fold. And still others, like nasal bone, that will increase the risk significantly. So short humerus, short femur, EIF, pelviectasis and hyperechogenic bowel do not increase the risk significantly. Hyperechogenic bowel likelihood is 1.6, but others are all 1 or less. Increased nuchal fold, ventriculomegaly and ARSA will increase the risk by 3 to 4 times, whereas nasal bone will increase the risk 6 to 7 times. So now you would wonder why these markers that are not increasing the risk are included. They're not even increasing the risk, they're even decreasing the risk. So why are we including using these markers? That is because even though the likelihood ratio isolated is very low, the moment you combine these, when there are two markers, your likelihood ratio increases to more than having an increased nuchal fold. So EIF and short FEMA will give you a ratio of 4.4, and EIF with pelviectasis 7.7, more than having just a single marker like absent or hypoplastic nasal bone. So when present in larger numbers, these significantly increase the risk, and therefore they are included in the risk calculation. I'll give you an example. This was a fetus, a 35-year-old woman. She had an NT scan, everything was normal. Her NT risk was 1 in 723. When she came for anomaly scan, we found short femur and EIF. Using these two parameters and a likelihood ratio of 4.4, her risk increased to 1 in 53. So naturally, you had to counsel her and offer her invasive testing. But of course, fortunately for her, invasive testing was done. The karyotype was not grossly abnormal, but they found some balanced translocation. However, it was not abnormal, and when we find something like this, what we do is we go back to the fetus, do a very detailed scan once again to make sure we are not missing any abnormality, and your geneticist will tell you whether this genetic report is anything to worry about. And if everything is fine, you just let the pregnancy continue. She delivered at term, and she has a healthy male baby. This is another example. This patient did not have a proper NT evaluation, and when she came for an anomaly scan, there was pelviectasis and absent nasal bone. So her age risk was 1 in 759, and with these two markers, her age risk went up to 1 in 66. So you had to advise her to have an invasive test. She had an amniocentesis, and the fetus turned out to be Down's. Now, I want you to notice one more thing. Sometimes we get this isolated marker, but her risk is very low. She's had a first trimester biochemistry, then she has had NT scan, and her risk is 1 in 10,000. And now when she comes to you, she has only hypoplastic nasal bone. And you're wondering, should I do an invasive test or not? Now, this is what I mean. When you find one marker, you look carefully for all markers, including what you don't routinely test for. In this fetus, if you notice, there is an absent nasal bone and there is an increased prefrontal thickness. So sometimes these clues help you decide whether you want to do an invasive test or not. There is a significant marker, but her risk is already very low. You will not advise her, but you will give her an option. You will tell her, I'm finding two markers. One is not very important, the other one is. So even though your risk is not going up, I would give you an option, because today you have non-invasive tests available and you have invasive tests which do not have a very high risk of miscarriage. So you give them the option. So it's worth looking at all these parameters. Okay. Now, another very important part of this risk assessment is that we can actually decrease the risk of a woman. Suppose there is a woman in her late 30s or 40, and she has a risk, a slightly higher risk after NT. She wasn't very keen on doing an invasive test, but she is anxious. If you find a very normal genetic sonogram and her risk was, say, 1 in 300, and she didn't know whether to do an invasive test or not, you could reassure her after this that she need not do, because her risk will come down significantly. For example, if her risk is 1 in 200, her risk could go on to 1 in 1500 and she could avoid an invasive testing. So what happens is, if you have seen all the parameters that we have mentioned in that chart and you didn't find any of those, then your risk can be lowered by 7 to 8 fold. 7.7 times if you exclude humerus and use the femur, and 8.3 times if you use the humerus and exclude the femur. That's just a calculation. And but suppose you are not able to do all the tests, that you could not see absent right separated, not that it is not there, but you could not evaluate because of unfavorable fetal position, and nasal bone could not be evaluated. In those women also, you can still continue to use, but you cannot use the same likelihood ratio. You use a different likelihood ratio of 0.4 and decrease the risk slightly lesser to 2.5. Or you can ask her to come back, reassess her, and if you can find the parameters, reduce it to a greater extent. But you have an option of not doing the more complicated markers if you don't want to. Now, when we look at, when we do genetic sonogram, besides this, we may come across other markers which are not mentioned here, but which are associated with Down's. Now, these markers are very, very mild, and there is so much of overlap between normal and abnormal that we cannot use them to advise the patient to go ahead and have an invasive testing. The classical examples are wide leg angle, sandal gap, clinodactyly, with a hypoplastic middle phalanx of the fifth digit. But if you do find any of these incidentally while you're scanning, it would be a wise policy to check the fetus carefully for any other markers. For example, hypoplastic nasal bone. The position wasn't good, but she has sandal wrap, and the mother or father do not have the sandal wrap. So you would be a little worried. Check more closely. Make sure you see the nasal bone well. Make sure you have looked at the other markers more carefully. Coming to prefrontal edema, as I told you, it is a marker, but it is not strong enough to be included in the routine screening yet. But if you do find it incidentally, you can calculate the risk. That is done like this. The distance from the bone to the outer surface of the skin is measured. That is one. And you draw a line from the anterior aspect of the mandible to the anterior aspect of the maxilla and extrapolate it upwards. And then you measure the distance between this line and the skin surface. That is the second measurement, B2. If you do B2 by B1, you get a ratio. And if that ratio is less than 1, that is a high risk for Down syndrome. So in this patient, we had this very obvious thick prefrontal edema. So we went ahead and calculated, and we got a value of 0.6. The ratio is referred to as prefrontal space ratio. So that is 0.46. That got us a little suspicious. And then we noticed incidentally that the baby is keeping its mouth persistently open, and the tongue is seen between the two jaws. The tongue should never be seen between the alveolar ridges anteriorly. It should be behind that. And this was persistently there. Macroglossia is one of the features of Down. Got a little suspicious, counseled the patient, we explained to her that these are not classical parameters. However, the option of NIPT and invasive testing was discussed. They chose to have an invasive testing, and the FISH report is normal. The karyotype is awaited. Now, coming to choroid plexus cyst, this is not a marker for trisomy 21, it's a marker for trisomy 18. I've particularly mentioned this because there's a lot of confusion regarding choroid plexus cyst. Now, choroid plexus cyst can be single, can be multiple, can be unilateral, can be bilateral. Can be small, can be larger than 1 centimeter, usually less than 1 centimeter. Sometimes they may be larger. And they are present in 1 to 2% of normal fetuses. Now, they are not a primary reason for advising an invasive test. You should not advise if they are isolated. Just like any other marker, if you find one marker, look carefully for any other marker. And if you do not find it, if it's truly isolated, you need not do any invasive test. The reason is, I will tell you that, CP cysts, when they are associated with something else, like NT, increased NT, structural abnormalities, growth restriction, particularly growth restriction with polyhydramnios, in these circumstances you can do an invasive testing. But if it is isolated, there is no need, because trisomy 21 is a condition amenable to ultrasound diagnosis. 92 to 98% of the trisomy 18 fetuses have structural anomalies, and not just one, usually multiple. So you can diagnose this condition by ultrasound. So why would you ask her to have an invasive test just on CPC with nothing else? You will put a healthy fetus at a risk of miscarriage. So it is not required. Moreover, these babies, even if you miss, they do not survive. So the mother does not have the problem of looking after a mentally retarded baby lifelong. So these are the things you need to consider. Do not jump to asking for a test for trisomy 18. Even when the trisomy 18 risk comes high by biochemistry, we prefer to do a detailed ultrasound examination, rule out all the markers. These are the markers you look for. You look for cardiac anomalies, you look for clefts in the face, particularly bilateral clefts. You look for limb abnormalities, a classical of trisomy 18, fisted hand, overlapping fingers, bilateral CTEV or rocker bottom feet, and of course IUGR is classical in these babies. IUGR polyhedron, if you find any of these, you might be dealing with trisomy 18. If not, most probably the baby is healthy. However, we, as I told you, we have non-invasive tests available, and we could try those if we are still anxious or the couple is still anxious. The take-home message therefore would be, when you do a mid-trimester anomaly scan, look for structural anomalies, yes, but also look for markers. You may sometimes pick up the 5 to 10% that you're going to miss by only a first trimester screening. Use likelihood ratios to calculate the risk. It makes it simple for you and for the patient to understand as well. The background risk, whatever the background risk that you use, can be any. It can be age, if nothing else is done before. But if first trimester biochemistry screening is done, age, NT and biochemistry risk can be used, or QST and age risk can be used. So anything can be the background risk, and this background risk can be either increased or decreased depending upon the markers you find. You count, depending upon the value of risk you get, you counsel the patient. When there are multiple non-conventional markers, then there is a little bit of controversy. What you need to do is you go into the history of the patient, see what screening she has had. Has she had all the screening that you would like her to have? If not, do further testing and see if you can alter the risk. For example, if she has not had NT, then you do a biochemistry. You can offer her NIPT and even discuss invasive testing, because the final choice is that of the couple. NIPT has a very high detection rate, and it is non-invasive and would be ideal in these circumstances where you are not very sure or you are at borderline risk and the patient is anxious. Invasive testing also is very safe today in experienced hands. The miscarriage rate has been quoted even in literature now as 0.11 to 0.22% only. Thank you very much.